I'm just going to say a few brief words of introduction, and I have a few questions to pose to our panelists. I've told them that I want it to feel mostly like a conversation. And after I've asked a few questions, we should have some time for questions from the audience if there are things that we haven't addressed that you'd be interested to talk about. When the time comes for me to ask for questions, I'm told that the expo would prefer for you to use the microphones that are in the aisles on either side, just so that we've got audio of the questions as well as us being able to hear it here. You know, posterity needs to be able to hear it. or YouTube, I guess, which is the current model for posterity. I'll just say really quickly who you're looking at, and then the first thing I ask them will actually allow them to talk a little bit more about who they are and what they do. But let me say, my name is Isaac Cates. My day job, I am a professor a teacher at the University of Vermont, where I teach some courses on comics and graphic novel. But I also sort of run a micro press myself. I mean, in that I publish a comic that has a bunch of people in it. I don't know. Yesterday I was on a panel about anthologies. Maybe it's an anthology. But we publish a lot of stuff, so maybe it's a micro press. I'm not really sure I don't know what I'm doing. I'm doing something. I stay busy, but I don't know what I'm doing. Anyway, here on the panel in front of you guys, you'll see Box, moving from my end down to the other end. This is Box Brown from Retrofit Comics. Kevin Czap from Czap Books. Francois Vigneault from Study Group. And on the end there, Lara Antal from So What Comics. And the first thing I want to ask you guys to talk about is just sort of, I guess it's sort of like asking you to tell your origin story or the origin story of your micropress. I'd like to know sort of what got you to make the transition from self-publishing to publishing other people's work, and how you kind of conceive of that that new role. Like what made you decide to do it, and maybe a little bit of what are you doing right now, although I can ask you more about that later.
Well, for Retrofit, I think that, I don't know, I think I was looking, I don't know what I was going through my mind when I started it. I know I was broke and I needed a scheme to make money. but I did, I think I always had kind of a fantasy of publishing. Ever since I got into comics, I always would think like, oh man, if I ever like won the lottery, I would I would start a comics press. I found out that you don't need to win the lottery at all to do that. But anyway, so I was publishing my own stuff, and I was selling it on my own store and stuff, and I remember thinking that if I could just make comics faster so I could sell more on my store, I could like make this into a reasonable business. And but I couldn't make them that fast, so I thought I could ask my friends to make comics and then we could make this big project. And so I ended up doing that, and I published like 17 comics in a row, like one a month for 17 months. And then I was like, that was too many. it was too fast and too many, because it was just I was running it just out of my office, and it was too many boxes, and it was just so much work. And then I was like, well, I'll only do 6 next year. And I think I got like halfway through, and I was like flat broke. And I was like, I don't know what I'm gonna do. I might have to just fold. I don't know. And it was like right around that time that I was approached by Jared Smith at Big Planet Comics about he wanted to get into publishing. And I was like, hey, how about you get into publishing Retrofit Comics? And we ended up becoming this great partnership, and it's been a few years now, and it's become really great because he runs one of the Big Planet Comics locations in Vienna, which is close to here, and has like a lot of experience with business and stuff, and I have like no experience with business. But I know what I like, and I know how to edit comics and stuff like that. So I'm able to just focus on the creative end, really, and I have Jared to do the business end. And so that's where we are now. But without Jared at that point, there would be no Retrofit Comics. So I never think he gets his due for that. So thanks, Jared. so that's it, I guess.
So I guess with me, I guess we're all like cartoonists on our own, like started self-publishing, and I kind of growing up, I was a part of this like DIY zine culture, and it like never really occurred to me that like somebody else would do it. Like not that they would like, you would submit and they would refuse, it was just you wouldn't, you're just like, you want to make a comic, you just do it. And I would look up to like Jeff Smith, it's like, oh, Bone, yeah, that's the way to go. So I started making my own comics, and then sort of the first couple shows, it was this huge table space, and I didn't have enough comics to fill it. But I knew a lot of people who made awesome stuff. It's like, hey, how about I sell your stuff at the table, and like, you know, I'm going to the show anyway, and it's better if we all sort of like get in on this. And it sort of went from there to, hey, how about we all like do a single book, like an anthology together. So we started doing an anthology along with my self-publishing stuff, and it kept growing. And it's like, man, I really love like encouraging people, like getting people on this train with me, because I'm already like obsessed, like in it to win it. And so I'm like, yeah, all right, we'll do this. And then as the anthology grew, I kind of was noticing all these other micro presses popping up, and it's super inspiring. It's like, yeah, I mean, sort of taking notes. It's like, what if instead of doing these anthologies where like a bunch of people did little things, I'm now leaning more towards, you know, publishing like standalone books. And so no, going from that like encouragement model, along the way, some friends have like called me their comics mom, and I was like, oh yeah, I like the ring of that. So it's like, so now I like, very proudly, he's like, yeah, I'm the comics mom, and this is sort of my family that I'm encouraging. It's like, I'll send care packages, like, no, come on, you'll take your book to the show. And it's like,
it's
now.
Also very much kind of like you're getting people to join your cult with you.
Yeah, totally. I'm like totally in the cult of comics, and I want to like share it. I've also done teaching. It's just like any way I can think of to like spread like my fever for comics. I'm like,
your and local this is branch like, office of the cult.
Exactly. Yeah. So I guess that's pretty much it. And I'm still early on the journey, but I'm having a good time.
For me, I'm the art director of Study Group Comics, and that's a company that has been in existence as an anthology since like 2001, but maybe for the last 3.5 years has had a lot of web comics and publishing a lot of comics for free online. And I joined that company when my older, when I folded my first small press that I had done for about 10 years before that, called Family Style, which was the printer of my comics and then other anthologies and things like that. And I had decided that there wasn't as much need for like what I was doing, and I could put more of my talents towards helping my friend who was Zach Soto, who's the publisher of Study Group Comics. And so I put more of my energy into that. So that's been interesting just to think about the kind of like the evolution of these small companies and how they can kind of bring other people, like Box was saying, about like bringing in other people who have different talents and things like that. So this is kind of like my second round of small being involved in small presses at this point.
So I'm Lara, and I'm one half of So What Press. The other half is Dave Kelly. We sort of came to be a press by, we came together as creators, and we're working on a comic he wrote, I illustrated, and we'd been going to a lot of these festivals and seeing a lot of great stuff, and we'd actually been going to a lot of these kind of panels and had sort of toyed and flirted with the idea of being a press. And then I went to a comic and cartooning residency in Florida at the Atlantic Center for the Arts in New Smyrna Beach, and I met a lot of cartoonists there, and there were 26 artists in total, and the work that they were producing was really diverse and really interesting. And we sort of thought, this is the opportunity to start publishing other people's work. So we produced this anthology called Breakers that collected work that was made during the residency, either projects that artists had been working on beforehand and continued at the residency, or projects about being in the jungle of Florida. And that was the launch. After that, we've been doing a lot of individual stories with different artists. We sort of see it as a way to, you know, we create our own work, and it's a very specific type of work, and, you know, we try different things, but there's just some things that I don't do that I really love. And so publishing comics is a great way to sort of involve, like, sort of help these stories get out there more, but also, like, bring together your tastes. We have a lot of nonfiction work. We have some more poetry work. It's just a diverse range, and publishing has been a nice way to have all those tastes and all those different talents kind of come under your fold and help you and help them work together. And it just, it makes sense for an eclectic aesthetic to be able to take a little bit of everything, even if you yourself aren't that kind of creator.
It's kind of like making a mixtape. Right?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. It's the greatest playlist you can ever make.
You mean the process of like choosing what's going to be in your catalog or building?
Yeah,
an
kind of. And it's
or...
also like when maybe I'm aging myself, but like I remember like you'd make a mixtape for your friends or whatever because you're showing them all the cool stuff that you've found and you want them to listen to it. Also, it's kind of like that, you know. It's like I want the people that buy Retrofit comics to know about these other things that I've. That I think are great, you know what I mean? It's very, you know.
And it's fulfilling in that way that it's your aesthetic, like in curating it, but you're showing off someone else's artwork. So right. You're kind of, it's just like.
I think there's also stuff like that when you're working, you know, when you get started and stuff, you're like, you don't know all the little tricks to like, you know what I mean? Like, you don't know anything, kind of like. And it takes, you have to like learn, to like make mistakes and stuff. So. We have already done all that stuff, so when a new artist comes, or just like artists in general, they don't have to think about that stuff as much as because we've already done all the work there.
Yeah, a lot of we've had artists at sort of different levels of how much they've published. We've had some artists who have worked in magazine publishing and like know the score, and we have other artists who just have always photocopied their work, and so it's kind of fun to be able to help these people who have. At the core, really interesting, exciting ideas and work, and be able to be like, okay, we can fill in the gaps where you need help. You just need help distroing and printing your work. We got it. You need help cleaning up these pages. We got it. And it's kind of, it's collaborative in that way, in addition to just sort of showing the work off.
Yeah, and totally. And some people just like don't have the same like inclination or drive to like put it up themselves. Like they make the work, and it's like so great and amazing. But they're just like, I don't want to like do the whole rigmarole. But that doesn't mean that people shouldn't see this work.
Right.
So.
And it's not even, it's not even that they don't want to. It's like, it's daunting, really, to be like, I have to promote this thing now. And like, people don't, you know, don't want to like sit there and talk
about
themselves.
It requires all these different skills.
Yeah.
Like
you kind of need
sense.
A booster. Yeah. You need someone else to be talking about your work for you because you can't always just be like, I'm great. You know what I mean?
It's always easier to promote somebody else's work, which is part of the fun of like printing other people's work. Is like, this is so
and
great.
And you can unabashedly promote it and not feel bad about it, you know?
People get tired of you saying your work's great.
Right,
like, I swear it's great.
People love the cheerleading, though, you know?
Yes.
And actually, in a way, that's one of your chief responsibilities as the person at the head of a micropress is like you pick out things that you really like, and then you tell everybody the reasons why those things are awesome.
Yeah, you have to. There's like when you're on the line for the money, you know, like you have to like. By hook or by crook, get those boxes of books out of your house. So it becomes, you know, that type of stuff is necessary. It really is. And without like trying to manipulate the public into buying your stuff, and just being like honestly being like, this is great, but also you have to be able to show people what's great about it in a like efficient way or something, you know.
I wanted to ask you guys about that making that mixtape, and in particular about how you find the people that you want to publish. I mean, I know that in some ways that's an unanswerable question because you know that you find them because they're around, you know, like you walk around the floor of SPX and they find you or you find them. But on the one hand, I want to ask, like, do you have interesting stories about people you found who you found through unusual means? Or on the other hand, like, what would be a typical way for you to find people? Or for that matter, are you even really looking for people? You know, at this point, do you know everybody you need to publish?
Yeah, no, I always look for new talent because we have an aggressive printing schedule and I need to fill up the slots. Like, we want to put out a book every month, so, you know. We gotta find people. And also, it's not even like that it's not a struggle. It really isn't. There's so much, there's so much talent and so little avenues, really, that it's you're overflowing with talent. It's like you could just reach out and grab whatever. It's like there's so much, you know. But really, so to me, it feels like there's never a time where I'm like, we gotta find somebody. It's always like, there's an abundance of people that I want to publish.
Do people just hand you stuff at a convention like this and say, you know, would you take a look at this? And
yeah, but I think that was going on before I started getting into publishing.
Yeah,
like that was part of the SPX culture, I think.
It
like,
still is. We still all just hand each other our stuff.
Yeah, you want people. You know, we're all making comics. Every person you meet out there doesn't make comics every day. You know what I mean? They're like regular people, and then you get around people that are like living your life the way you're doing it, and like you don't see that every day. It's like you want to connect with them and learn from them and whatever. It's like part of being part of the community is so great, you know. Without being part publishing it, you know what I mean? Just for the feedback and I think that's part of what makes editing stuff like this good too, is working with the artist. And like as an artist, you learn a crap load from other artists, just seeing their process and like how they format their pages. Like every aspect of it is something you can learn and put to use on your own work, I think.
We have sort of two avenues of publishing artists. It's sort of become this way unconsciously, but when we find artists at SoWhat Press, like a lot of them are people we've had relationships with, especially if we're publishing like one mini of theirs or they're something really intimate, a complete work. We normally get to know them. We don't just sort of do open calls on that front. But then Dave and I also publish this ongoing series, Tales of the Night Watchman. Like I said, he writes and I illustrate, but we have a lot of backup stories. And that's sort of an option where we're going out and finding people a little bit more based on an aesthetic. The artists we've had with that have all been a little bit different, but that's a little bit more of our wild card. And the other stories have developed more naturally as you get to know more people and you get to see people's work develop. So we kind of enjoy having those two options because they're two very different ways to work with an artist. One hand letting someone like publish their story and another hand having someone use their style and their sensibilities on a story that we've worked on. So it's a whole mess. But yeah, there's no shortage of talent, as everyone probably knows being here, and their eyes are melting from being on the floor.
Yeah, that's why everybody goes home broke, you know? It's
right.
For us too, we have the benefit of we publish things on the web, so we put which is a really great way that we can have a lower threshold, you know, so someone can just approach us and be like, hey, I want to publish a story. And that one, it's an easier call to make. It's like, do we like the story? Do we think that there's people are going to be interested? Okay, let's do it. And it's like an easy call. And then there's this other tier that's like, well, okay, now do we want to invest a bunch of money into this particular book or publication? And like, is that going to be a winning program for us? And so then there's like these kind of different tiers that you can do. It's kind of similar to doing like a backup story. And then if you really care about the artist or if people are really responding to it. So
that is like when you have like for the web. So is a pretty good like metric for you guys. Like when you see like a story that's being read constantly, mm-hmm. it's like you can, yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, it makes a big difference. I would. And it's just interesting too, because there's also this multiplier effect, because you know there's like, I don't know, I have no idea, but maybe like 50 different artists have their work on this website. So then you can just look at it, and then if you like one thing, you can like another and like nothing, and then it's a similar effect, as I'm sure you've all seen at like a table, you know, where you have 6 different artists, 10 different artists, publications, and it. To me, it's a more satisfying tabling experience also than the experience of being behind your table and it's just you and maybe your friend.
Yeah.
And it's like, this is me. I'm the artist who did this. And I did that for so many years that like being a publisher and being now an art director of a publisher, it's so much more satisfying because there's a wider diversity of things. You can talk about different things. You can capture different segments of the audience too.
Yeah.
I feel like we all got into this because we like to engage with not only our work, but other people's work. And so like the more sort of tiers you can have to be able to interact with people as an artist is pretty exciting. It's also smart. It also is like you have the urge to want to do it. So it's like how, you know, and if finances are obviously a concern, so you can't print everybody, but that's a great idea to be able to do it digitally and like, yeah, we can do it. We can do all this and not have to stress ourselves out always about the certain trials and tribulations that come with each medium.
Can I ask you guys a couple of like basic behind the scenes questions that I don't actually know the answers to myself, and some other people might be interested too. Like, when you go to print a book, how many copies of it do you print? Can I ask that question? Do you mind telling people?
Yeah, we've steadily gone up with like more printing more and more because it reduces the price per book, right?
Yeah.
So we try to, like when I first started, like when I got started, my philosophy was to try to just print as many books as I can, but that I wouldn't, that I could sell through in like a year. So we did that. We were doing that, and then like this year for a couple of our books, we were just like 1,500 was our standard print run, and that would give us like a good price and a good whatever. But, and that pretty much works, but like a couple of our books have already sold out like in six months, like, so we had to reprint, and that's a whole nother fucking pain in the ass, because you're like, you should have just printed more the first time, it would have saved us X amount of dollars,
yeah,
we wouldn't have like a gap in
shipping. But you have to watch out, because once in a while you'll print 3,000 of a book, and then it won't, you'll sell really fast, you'll sell through that first 1,000, and then you're like, oh, that was the print run for the book.
Right,
and
we
made a mistake, and we printed 3,000, and now, like, not for study group, but for my old publisher, like, I've dumped books, you know, because I, like, because you do get tempted by that really low price point, and you're like, $1? Yes, I want 3,000 if they're going to be $1 each, and then I'll sell them for $12, I'll make a lot of money.
Right.
And then you realize after a while, you're like, when you're throwing them away, you're just like, but like, because there's a certain audience for your book, it's there's a certain level, which is nothing, it was no failure, it's just that I bought too many.
Yeah, I remember, reprinting too is the same issue. I mean, you'd be like, all right, it's sold out, so we have to reprint, right? And then, but yeah, that the print run was like 10 more than you printed or something, you know?
But can I ask again, like, how many, the rest of you guys, so 1,500 is a ballpark that I heard you say.
For sure.
Can you?
So for me, I've been like pretty cautious, like slowly raising the number. Like when I started, it was like, I was doing specifically print on demand, so it was maybe like 60 at a time, but now I've been like printing in the hundreds, and my book, Feature Perfect, that just came out, is like 500. Our next book, Bug Boys, this December, will be 1,000. So we're kind of like, you know, slowly like learning our ground, not like overshooting, like eating all that cost. I don't want to have to like throw things away, but like slowly like runs paying for themselves, paying for the next book.
Sort
of like growing steadily and finding out, like, because, you know, I'm new to the scene as a publisher, so sort of like want to make a space for myself before.
Yeah. In terms of capital, it's a lot easier to do something like print on demand, but there are options that are closed off to you, like offset printing. You can't do print on demand.
Yeah, print on demand
is way cheaper if you're going to run, like, offset is way cheaper if you're going to run more than 1,000.
Exactly. It's all about scale. Like, when I started, it was a scale where print-on-demand made sense, and then I was, like, very consciously is like, well, this doesn't make any sense anymore.
I mean, we always try to keep, like, I always have, like, a formula for pricing that keeps it everything as cheap as it can be. Like, I try to never, like, even if we get a good deal on something, I try to keep it, like, if we get a good deal, I try to pass it on, right? So that's why, like, Magley's Mirror is only $8, and, like, we try to keep it cheap. Like, that's one of the reasons I started Retrofit was because I went to a comic shop and I was like, I just needed to buy a comic for the bus ride home. You know what I mean? Like, I wasn't looking to buy like a $20 graphic novel. I wasn't looking to like spend a lot of money. I needed like 5 minutes of entertainment. And I went to the comic shop, and all they had was like superhero comics and stuff for that price, for like,
which won't last you for a bus ride.
Yeah. But I bought a bunch. I bought like 3 superhero comics, and I hated all of them. I was like, I just needed something to read. So, then I was like, there should be. This was in the time where graphic novels were the thing, and everybody stopped printing like shorter run comics. Mm-hmm. And I was like, no, like that. We need those. Like. Yeah. We need them as artists, and we need them as readers. It's awesome. Like to, and you need that as like a short barrier of entry for people that are like just trying out alternative comics and stuff like that. Or
you mean readers?
Yeah.
Yeah, readers, and also for cartoonists, right? Like
yeah.
not every cartoonist has a 200-page work in them.
Honestly, if you're just getting started, and
for anybody, if, like, a graphic novel is a huge undertaking, right? And it's hard to, like, maintain everything. It takes a really long time. So if you're just getting started and you're like, okay, this is my first work, it's going to be a 300-page graphic novel. For one thing, by the time you get to page 300, your work's going to look nothing like page one. And you're going to be working, like, in silence for 2 years, and then all of a sudden you put out this thing. Whereas if you're making mini comics, you're putting out like 20 pages and you're in the public eye all the time. And
I always tell my students who want to make graphic novels that it's like writing yourself a prison sentence, where you have to follow the instructions of a three-year-old, a version of you that's 3 years younger. You know, like if you plan it all out and you're going to write this exactly as it is, you're telling the version of you 3 years later that you right now know better than they do. And that's nuts, because you're going to grow and get smarter and get better as you get older. And you don't want to have to be following the instructions of the 15-year-old version of yourself when you're 18.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Because you're better.
As an artist, I've always found that you really don't get a good critical eye until you've spent the money to print it. After you've done all the work.
You can't even see typos.
That's where you see the typos,
So why not keep it small?
I have another behind-the-scenes question that is maybe harder to answer, but really just a yes or no question in some ways, which is... are you actually making money?
We're not losing money.
Yeah, breaking even is pretty sexy.
Retrofit is successful. I consider it successful. I don't really take a paycheck from it.
Yeah, that's a different sort of definition of success, right?
But I mean, I think that like I could at the end of the year. You know what I mean? Like I think if we calculated everything. At the end of the year, me and Jared could both take money home. But we don't, first of all, it's not that much, right? And the other thing is that we don't really want to at this point, because we just want to invest that back into the business. So it's, for me, I look at it as the benefit of, a lot of times when I come here, it comes out of the retrofit budget.
Yeah.
When I travel somewhere, we can put that out of the retrofit budget. And it helps me, because then when I get there, like all that money that I make selling comics is just pays for myself. And so, I mean, yeah, we're Retrofit is making money. Box Brown is making money from another place.
Yeah, it's definitely a tumble thing. You're getting a little money, you're putting it back in, but then, you know, hey, I'm rolling. It's fine. Like, I'm moving. So, yeah, we're, you know, I think So What Press, we do the same thing where if we're making it, it's going back into the fund to either go to the next book or to help us get to the next fest. And so, yeah, I would have to say ditto.
I think I'm setting Czap Books up to make money. Like, I'm currently, like, investing and, like, I'm finally investing smartly. So I feel like right now I've put a lot into it and I'm getting a lot back, but it'll like, maybe not this year, but in the next year.
It's really weird with the whole business running thing, because it's like you get money and you're like, dude, I got tons of money, like we're great. But then it's like, oh wait, that's like, I had to use that money to pay for printing stuff, not my rent and my food.
Postage.
Yeah,
it's nice postage. Having this huge like, bank statement, and then they cash your print bill.
Okay. Great. Or you do a bunch of pre-orders, you know, and have a bunch of money, and then you're shipping like a maniac. Shipping is awesome.
Do you like it, or are you?
No. It's horrible, but you turn into like a machine. Don't you? Like you yourself become the machine. You're just like throw it out.
I used to hire undergrads to do shipping for me, and then I realized that I needed the money. So now I become the machine.
It's business financing versus personal financing. And I think as people who've self-published, that transition from where you're running it as a business versus like putting it in your pocket is kind of a different thing. And you learn, and there's, you know, we were talking about print runs that could stay with you forever, that could build your tombstone someday. You know, you learn how to fine tune those things and what things you need to do to make a little money and what things you need to do to satisfy your creative curiosity. And
it was a massive benefit to me to hook up with Jared, like who's someone who like, when I was doing it myself, I was like, yeah, like I'm a cartoonist, but I kind of know business now. Like I know what I'm doing. And then like, Jared gets involved and he like knows how to actually do it. And like I'm just like, oh, I didn't know anything at all. Like,
yeah, it helps, you know, to have two people. Dave and I bounce stuff off of each other, and it's just like, you know, you get in your own head, and you're like, this makes sense. And I'm like, that actually has no logic in the real world. And it's just
yeah,
from
oh, it's so great. It's like, you know, and he kind of thinks about the comics from a different side than I do, more from the retail side and less from the creative side. So
yeah,
very helpful.
Dave used to be in film, so he's definitely thinking it from like a producer standpoint. And I used to work in arts administration, so I'm thinking about the punishment side, like constantly being punished by my work. So,
what do you think is the hardest part of the process? Like, what is the part that you sweat the most, or that you feel least competent with right now, or that you had to learn the most in order to pull off?
Right now, I'm having problems with margins.
Wait, do you mean like the in financial terms or
just
like printing?
Page margin, literally.
More
I,
is better.
I laid. I know. I feel like there's never enough margin. And then sometimes it gets printed, and like your part of your comic gets squished into the center of the book, and you don't want that. So I got to get that together. That's the hardest thing I'm dealing with right now.
So you like know all that though.
Yeah.
The art director.
Oh, yeah. I got it. No
I
problem.
Saw margins years ago, man.
I think the hardest thing for me and for our company right now is just I think that you do have to get to a certain point where you hit all the little details all the time. And that is, like, I know I'm personally, like, a kind of a big picture, like, what's up? We're going to do this creative thing. And don't worry about this little thing and this little thing. And then I'm slowly realizing that it's all those little things that will put you over the top and make you, like, people care about your company, they want to give you money, they want to get published by you, because you're a known quantity that's excellent, because you hit all your marks. But if you don't hit all your marks, people are like, those guys, they were really, really late with their book, but they're cool dudes, but I don't really want to do that much more for them, or whatever. Or just like, when your book's late, it affects your audience in a way that I don't think I realized, you know, because I was just like, oh, you can have a book be 2 months late. What's the big deal? And no, there's a huge audience that's like mad at you if your book's 2 months late, and they have other things that they can buy with that time too.
Even if they're not mad at you, they
forget about you. Or you know, just getting your shipping on time every time. All those little details. It's like, and that's the hardest part that I'm learning the most about right now. Just make sure you get those little details right. So because if you don't, you're just kind of gonna. It's the difference between being excellent and being pretty good. And if you want to do this and make any kind of money or anything, you probably have to be excellent because there's so many people doing it.
Go ahead.
Oh well, just that, especially you know, study group is such a like a beautiful looking product, and it's you know, it just you as a reader you just take it for granted. You're like, wow, great, it's amazing. Like, and that's like good thing it just was born amazing. But like if you're doing it right, it just comes off almost like it's easy.
Yeah, all the million things are right. Just invisible.
I'm doing it wrong, it's right there.
not frustrated, but it's just I don't know. I'm losing my understanding of it. Is what like Tumblr, like that's like a big promotional force, right? I mean, that's like a thing a lot of users use, right? Facebook doesn't work that way because of the way they set up their timeline. Like if you're like the Retrofit Facebook page, like no one ever sees it. Right. Like we post and no one sees it because they don't let you promote your business stuff.
As a side note, Facebook does not like to promote links that go outside of Facebook. So if it's a photo, you're gonna get more people seeing it.
Yeah, there's ways to game the system. It's really weird. But Tumblr just goes in there, so you have to kind of use it, and then I don't know. I feel like if I don't post something every day or two, I'm like, oh, we have to make sure everybody knows about all this stuff. And then I'm like, maybe my Tumblr post doesn't look right in people's feeds. And it's like, it's really a weird necessary evil to learn that stuff.
Yeah, I have noticed it's like really difficult to control like the Tumblr post. It's like, oh, it looks great. And then you see it on somebody else's wall. It's like,
No, it's not supposed to look like that.
It's like they like control the coding really.
Yeah.
Hardcore, like even if you know HTML, you throw in all the styles, they just wipe it clean. It's like, nope, you're in Tumblr now.
And then it's weird, like also like if you want to promote something on Tumblr, you like if you include a GIF in it, it'll like get like, it'll get like 20% more notes just because it has a stupid moving thing on it.
Yes.
And then it's like, does that even do anything? I don't even know. Like, stuff gets like 20,000 notes. That doesn't mean it's $20,000 or anything like that.
The social media to sales translation is a very elusive one.
It is, but it's also completely necessary somehow. Yeah. And you're just like, it's so elusive to what actually moves the numbers.
Oh, I think you have to think about it as advertising that you don't pay for, right?
Yeah.
You have to think about, like, it's hard, but you have to think about, like, some conversion rate of, like, 0.0001%. So, like, you know, like, if you have 20,000 people, like, heart your thing, then, like, 2 people will buy it, you know? Like,
yeah.
And it seems really weird, but I do not know how to do it, but it seems like the most success you're going to have is just, like, you just have to put out so much stuff, and then there will just slowly accrete this group of people that are interested in what you're
doing.
It's
like a probability percentage. It's like the more you're seeing is a higher chance that like
it's so nebulous as to what.
Yeah. But you'll never see a 1-to-1. You'll never be like, yes, this person liked this thing and then I saw.
It's so true because like even if you think, sometimes you'll get a link on a site or something and that produces sales, right? But that's totally nebulous, right? So like you'll get something that you think is like this huge like piece of like whatever promotion that is on a big website, and you're like, holy cow, like boing boing or something linked to it, and then that doesn't even produce sales, but like something else happens to hit the buyers of this thing. It's like so completely.
Yeah, we got mentioned for like 20 seconds in a podcast about a Slate podcast about parenting, and got I think 45 new subscriptions.
Wow.
So like it was like something like $1,000 or more of sales from this really brief little mention where the guy who runs the podcast was enthusiastic about it.
Dan Coyce.
And yeah, Dan Coyce, right. And he's a subscriber and his daughter is into the comic. So
I
didn't even know that he was gonna do it. It just happened. And it was not advertising, but it worked better than any advertising I've done.
Right.
I spent a month putting new stuff on Tumblr every single day this summer, and I don't know that it made more than 2 sales.
I would say that it's a huge, like what you just pointed to is a gigantic thing, which is that there's an audience of people out there for the work that is being produced here, and it's not the same as the audience that's here in this room,
right.
This convention.
Know.
And it because the people, like, you can keep reaching out to that same audience, and they'll like, you'll penetrate that audience, people will know a little bit, but what you really want to do is reach outside to, you know, if you get, like, a mention in Bust magazine, like that's going to be way more important than if the Comics Journal like wrote like a really really glowing review.
I honestly think, and not to shoot to trash the Comics Journal at all, because I love them, but they mean that as far as sales go, that means almost nothing.
Or I mean like to get mentioned on a blog that's not about comics is more important than to get mentioned on a blog that's about comics, I think, you know.
You know, a lot of our bestsellers, like I did a book that's a guide to making coffee. I mean, that book we have in so many different kinds of stores and coffee shops and different kinds of retail, and like that sort of thing is able to bring in a crowd that's not just comics related, and that's always really helpful.
It's important. It seems like you're just like, it's like, oh, it's just, I'm just getting coffee money. It's just whatever. But it's really actually important because you're opening people's eyes to, like, comics. They may never, ever see one. Like, they only have this picture of what comics are in their head, and it's Ziggy or X-Men or something, you know?
Yeah, that's definitely been, like, a challenge for me is, as I've established, I'm in the comics cult. It's like everything. It's like, oh, yeah, of course the comics press and, like, learning, like, retraining my brain. It's like, no, like, you want the people outside.
Yeah.
I mean, if SPX is, like, a microcosm of the universe, you come in, there's so much great stuff. It's really easy to, like, get visual fatigue and, like, hard. So, like, it's good to have people who have not seen this kind of work, people who aren't into comics, who do not know much about comics, or people who have interest in other things. I mean, comics that cross over onto different sort of genres.
So but one thing that we could observe to you guys is that one of the best things you can do after SPX is become sort of a little missionary, you know, like take some of the cool stuff that you buy upstairs and show it to somebody who doesn't know about indie comics and tell them, like, there's a whole world of this stuff.
There's a lot of comic shops that don't even, that a lot, like most comic shops have no understanding that there is a small press or an alternative. Yeah, like there's a large portion of this country that we can't get our books into that state, really, except for mail order, because there's just no shops there that are interested, or they're just buying their comics from Diamond or whatever it is.
Can I ask you guys a question? So we recently started working with like alternative comics, and we're getting some of our comics through Diamond now. Which, and if you don't know, Diamond is the very large distributor that distributes all the comics to every normal comic book store. So they distribute all the comics and toys. And are you guys? Are any of you being distributed?
Yeah,
to Diamond
right
now?
We're in there. Yeah.
Okay.
No.
Diamond is a necessary evil type place, right? I'm sorry, does anybody work for Diamond? But they're the only distributor. They're the only distributor, right, to these shops. So there's like, if you can't get in there, then you're going to not get to like 1,000 comic shops. And they do weird stuff. Yeah, whatever. They're okay, I guess.
I just asked because I think that that's something that just happened recently, where we just started doing this kind of collaborative, cooperative thing with a couple other publishers and getting our stuff into Diamond. And I've already seen, like, the difference, which it's interesting, you know, just, like, it was unexpected. But, you know, like, it's, like, the stores that you have no clue about. Like, so not the cool store in the city that you've been to and you know the person and you call them, and but like some other place is picking up your comics and things
right.
like that.
And it's really great too. I love that. Yeah. I mean, like we got a shop recently in Florida started carrying us, and the dude that runs it is like so enthusiastic because he's like, I've never seen this stuff before, you know?
Yeah. You know, it's a really brilliant idea, and we don't do, we've looked into doing, working with distributors, but we actually do everything ourselves. But it, again, two of us. So if I'm working on some drawing, Dave might go out and do some pitching. But we're in over 60 stores in the U.S., U.K., mm-hmm. and Canada. But it's been a lot of grassroots. And like, you know, on the subject that there's so many shops that won't necessarily take small press, we've gotten into quite a few that don't seem small press friendly. Some of them that will take it once and it'll never happen again. Sometimes we'll be able to get them to reorder, but it's, you know, regular non-small press comic shops are very tentative about taking that type of material because they don't think their customers will read it.
Yeah.
That being said, you know, it's sort of a little tit for tat. If you're a store owner and you start carrying these things and recommending them to your customers,
yeah.
that's
really
going to change the taste.
Like a store owner or a store, somebody works there or something that's really into it that can be
yeah.
a
you need
missionary.
A champion.
Yeah.
yeah.
But, you know, I feel like in general, the difference we were talking about, why, what are some of the challenges of being a micropress? It's just that everything you're doing is numbers and in multiples. So whether it's the business side or the advertising side, it's just all about quantity versus being a single self-publisher, which is like we're one-to-one sort of ratio. That makes sense when you make your one comic, you can track it very well. But when you've got multiple projects and multiple things going on, it's a lot of
yeah.
It's a lot
I forget
of bulk
some. I like forget. Like I can't off the top of my head. I'm just like we have a lot of artists we're working with. I can't remember
right.
them all really. I mean, I have them all. You know, I have my files and stuff. But
and you've worked with them individually, and
yeah.
that was such a great process.
Sure.
But then like here they are all amalgamated into one. So
yeah.
it's yeah a lot of big stuff and a lot of small stuff, and trying to balance all that.
Let me see if anyone in the audience has questions for our panelists. We've got probably another 10 minutes or so before we absolutely need to clear the room, but the next panel will be starting in 15 minutes. So if there are questions in the audience for these guys, now's the time for you to ask them. I see somebody heading for the mic over here. You could probably take at least two, yeah?
I have a question.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Please do.
Hi. So as I understand, a lot of the people on the panel started out from humble beginnings, just sort of scraping by. And I was wondering, was that a decision that you just flew into full-time, dropped everything, you know, and just dedicated yourself to it? Or was it that everyone had bills to pay and was doing other work on the side?
Well... In my what I did was I was working like a full-time job in like communications for like this big company, and I wanted to move to Philadelphia to move in with my girlfriend, and so I quit and I like moved to Philly, and then like it was like in September 2008, so like my plan was to like move to Philly and like work on comics for like a month, but eventually get another job. And it was like right as the stock market crashed. in 2008, so I couldn't get a job. And so I kind of, and then I got the Zurich, won the Zurich grant, and I was just like trying to keep go, like get by. And then I got a job. I was working part-time at, I was got a job working at a company that distributes porn. And I had to like do data entry and like describe all the movies.
That's where the money.
And I got fired. I got fired because I had so many typos in it. And then like I worked delivering pizza for a long time and like part time while I was making art. And then it's only been like the last, well, I guess last few years now that I've been doing it full time.
I just up until recently had a full-time graphic design desk job that paid very well, and you know, I live pretty modestly, so that was sort of the bankroll for starting out Czap Books. It was kind of like the training wheels, and like sort of put in this money that I could like replenish pretty easily. I just had to keep working, and like I could make my mistakes, and I had my last month there back in February, so it's like, all right, I've got all this money set up, I've got these, like, I've learned some lessons, let's see how it goes. So I quit, I've like traveled a bit, sort of like started publishing more seriously, and so I'm sort of still in a humble beginning, but I sort of was very lucky to have that opportunity to sort of learn on somebody else's dime. Yeah. To a certain extent.
I think generally you stay, cartoonists stay pretty humble. There's humble beginnings and they move on to humble middling, middles and then humble endings. But I think it's about, you like, one of the things to do, like, that I could recommend to any cartoonist is, like, learn how to be cheap as hell in, like, your daily lives. like be frugal. Like, it's very helpful.
Get a good beans and rice recipe.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've always sort of worked part-time on one thing, part-time on another thing, and in all my spare time work on comics. So for a long time I worked in coffee, which was both funding and fodder for comics, and then I worked in arts administration, which was also miserable. And now I'm happy to say I work part-time at Random House Children's Books, and then I do part-time illustration, but that sort of part-time flexibility has allowed me the ability to work on other things. I mean, I say part-time, but it's like I'll have two part-time jobs at the same time and then comics on top of that. So it's sort of a confusing sandwich. But, you know, it's funny to be asked if you work in comics full-time because as soon as I leave the office on the days that I'm in, I go home and I start working on comics and I'm doing it all night. And then people are like, what are you doing this weekend? I'm like, why are you asking that? You know what I'm doing. I'm sitting at my desk. I'm sitting at a computer working on comics.
I started taking Sundays off.
That's good. You should do that because it makes you a human.
Yeah,
but
yeah. I did no days off for like 5 years and I like went insane.
Yeah,
that's the other thing that happens. You like start, like things start failing, like your body, your brain.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I've had a bunch of health issues from comics. Like one time I was drawing, I used to draw standing up. And like
was
on
that
my
no
desk.
Good?
No, that was great. I actually that's not the injury. Well, actually, I started drawing standing up because I was sitting too much, right?
Yeah, that's where I'm at. It's like, yeah. I'm done with sitting, standing.
So then I started drawing standing up, and I was leaning on my drawing table, like, so much that my drawing table broke while I was drawing on it, and it, like, flung back and hit me in the head. And then I had to get a new drawing table. But so those are a couple injuries, right? I also have got an ulcer one time. Like BS, like stress, like an anxiety and stuff. Like,
you do have to take care of yourself.
Yeah,
I
doctor actually told me, like, you have to sleep more than 4 or 5 hours a night.
Yeah, it's really good. I mean, I started exercising and like walk, like leaving my house. You like you do these things, like you forget, you know, that you know, you're like, I don't have to do anything, so I don't have to go anywhere. But then you have to because you'll go.
Hey, you guys, we have a lot of questions, so
yeah,
maybe
we should ask. Go ahead, and I can maybe fit into maybe three, but go ahead.
Well, we knew you'd get to us eventually. No, but it's really interesting, and I thank you. This is a question about the distribution, and I'm very sensitive to what you were saying with regard to getting into stores. What I wanted to ask was, have any of your grassroots efforts at marketing ever generated a sort of groundswell to where you know, people go to the store and they say, hey, you've got to bring this small press in because we want to buy this?
Yes.
I'd say that's true. Definitely I've gotten calls from shops, like that people have come in and asked for stuff.
No.
You know, some shops there's a champion. Some shops there's not. That's kind of it. If you can get someone with a voice on your side, that's always good. But
that is really important, though. If you like a comic and they're published in Diamond, you should go to your shop and tell the publisher, the store, that they want to order it. Because if it's an indie thing, they won't order it at all if people don't ask. Yeah. It's a big deal.
Talk to your local comic people. It's true, though. I mean, because they want to know what you like, really. I mean, like,
they won't order it if you're not
going to
buy it.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's good for them to know what their audience is into.
Yeah. One more question.
I was wondering if there's any kind of like checklist for when an illustrator or author comes to you, like to get it print ready, or if there's any like big like no, like why did you do that? Like you can't do that. We can't print it like that. Anything like that.
I haven't run into that.
Yeah, you know, we work closely with our artists, so if things come up like that, it's like you need to fix that page or we'll fix this part, and it's pretty organic. There's never been a moment where we didn't let it go unchecked.
Most people who know how to send you art digitally know how to format it digitally so that it'll run.
Yeah. Read the whatever instructions people give you, because they know what they're talking about. And then if you're doing art, just make sure the best thing is just make sure it's big enough that you can deal with it later. Like, so make sure your scans are large enough and a high enough resolution. Because you can fix all kinds of other stuff, but if you scan your art at 75 DPI and then you sell your artwork and then you're like, here, it's ready to publish, it's not going to work anymore, and you have a hard time with that. You can't fix it, so.
Over here.
Okay. You mentioned getting a grant, and I was wondering how much of a role outside funding or that can play in running your business?
Well, I got a personal grant when I was younger, but we also ran a Kickstarter campaign when we first started that helped us get off the ground. I think Kickstarter is actually pretty great because there's like 10% of your funders come directly through Kickstarter.
It's more than 10%.
Yeah, okay. So
it's half usually.
So these are people that wouldn't have seen your work otherwise. So it's also like good promotion in and of itself.
Any of you other guys have any experience with grants or?
Not grants, but I just wanted to shout out that it's like, you know, the community. I've been very lucky to have people like really be supportive, and like some people have like just given me money, and just like, you know, it's very encouraging to have somebody be like, I believe in you, here's some cash, like go get it.
Yeah, we'll do one more question, and then I guess I'm sorry, but you can find us at our tables upstairs and ask, you know, and that goes for everybody, of course. Come to the tables upstairs and see all the cool books that everybody here has to offer, and also, you know, buy something. But go ahead and ask one more.
You guys have wonderfully clever names for your micropresses. I just want to say that. But is there any type of like copyright that you had to do in order to, protect the name or something like that? And what is the process to go through that if it's necessary?
I have a relevant story about that. So we recently, I never did anything like that, right? So I didn't even think about it, right? All I did was Google Retrofit Comics, and there wasn't one, so. Recently we found a company that was publishing regular books called Retrofit Publishing. So we had to go through this whole process of trademarking Retrofit Publishing. And then we had to get a lawyer and have him call this dude's lawyer, write a bunch of mean letters to each other, and then it's a real pain in the ass. So, yeah, if you are at all concerned about that, I would recommend doing the trademark thing. I don't know if anybody else has gone through that.
I don't have like a trademark or anything like that, but Czap Books is registered with the state of Ohio. It's like a doing business as like fictitious entity, so.
Yeah, there is a difference between copyright and registered trademark. We have registered trademark. Some things we have copyrighted, and it really depends on how you're using it. It's sort of a whole big legal thing, and I recommend if you can ever go to a workshop about that. It's, you know, I it's totally different copyright as an artist versus trademark as an entity that puts out multiple publications. We have a lawyer, she's great, and we can ask her questions anytime, and she's helped us not only do that, but do contracts for artists and keep it all by the books.
Okay, well, thanks for turning out for the panel, and I hope you'll come visit everybody upstairs.
Give everybody our table.